Thanks for joining us on the premiere of Native Report's 17th season. I'm Ernie Stevens.
Thanks, Ernie. I'm Rita Karpinen. We're taking you to the start of the Red Cliff Band of Lake Superior Chippewas stand against the commercial sale of the largest of the Great Lakes.
If you love the land, you're going to protect it.
Plus, a Native-led company in Minnesota wants society to take a new path away from fossil fuels and towards solar heating solutions.
And over in Oklahoma, a Native-run meat processing plant honors traditional values and provides a model for indigenous self-sufficiency.
We also learn what we can do to lead healthier lives and hear from our elders.
Production for Native Report is made possible by grants from the Blandin Foundation, Anishinaabe Fund, and Alexandra Smith Fund, in support of Native American treaty rights, administered through the Duluth Superior Area Community Foundation.
Welcome to Native Report, and thanks for tuning in.
This is the 17th season of Native Report. In this episode, we're exploring energy and natural resource operations led by Natives that align and honor traditional ways, as well as efforts to protect natural resources in the name of stewardship responsibilities.
We're starting with a story about one tribal nation's stand to protect the water around them. We take you to the Red Cliff Reservation at the start of their stand against any commercial sale of Lake Superior water, after a private company's efforts to sell water from an artesian well in Herbster, Wisconsin surfaced.
My initial thoughts when I heard of someone wanting to create a water bottling company, you know, not too far down the shore from us, I deemed that as a threat, as I would if someone were to say, we're gonna come into your community and for no reason, take an elder out of your community or one of your children, and you wanna protect it. You wanna make sure you get your arms around that those beings or the resources and you know that's just the way we are. I'm Brian Bainbridge. I'm a at-large council member here in the Red Cliff Band, Lake Superior Chippewa. There's a company that wants to come in and extract water within the basin and right along the shores of Gitche-Gaming, Lake Superior. And we deemed that as a threat.
I remember talking to elders way older than me, talking to elders, and they talk about places that are sacred all along this lake. The land that I live on, we call Musquabicong. Musquabicong means like a place that's red. So if you go out in Lake Superior and the sun rises and you look back at Red Cliff, it's all red. Marvin Defoe from Red Cliff Band, Lake Superior Chippewa. My Shinabe name, Shingwe Benes. The reason why I'm against the bottling of water is because I love water. And there's certain unforeseen hazards of taking water out of the soil, taking water out of the land, taking water, because you're taking water right from Lake Superior. You're taking the aquifer. It's going to set a precedent that's going to keep going and going and going. And pretty soon, the homeowners, the landowners, they're going to turn their faucet on. There ain't going to be no water. Our ancestors never gave up the water rights, if you will. Never gave it up. You look in the treaties, there's no mention of water. There ain't no mention. The Chippewa people has never gave up the right to voice and to protect water. We have never made those agreements with the federal government. We still have them rights. See, our ancestors were pretty smart back in then, and we're pretty smart today too.
You know, we sit here well over 160 years past, you know, the last agreement that was signed in 1854. And if that thought wasn't put forth with that seventh generation, we would not even be having this conversation.
It's going to set precedents, my initial thought. I'm thinking of the drought that's taking place in California. The drought that's taking place throughout, you know, different places. This lake, that water to us is very valuable. Freshest lake, clean water in the world. We need to have the talk about the protection of Lake Superior, the protection of Michigan.
I'm a commercial fisherman. Right now our nets are just a couple miles away from Herbster. Those are resources that we've retained. And any threat to that has an impact, not only to me as a commercial fisherman or a provider for our community, but as a nation. People have to understand that as sovereigns. We have an obligation to not only the people, but to our land and water. Get your gomming, Lake Superior. If there's any type of threat, you know, we take that. It's our lifeblood. If we don't maintain that way of thinking and that thought process, thinking forward, and we allow certain things to happen, whether it be water extraction, mineral extraction through mining, we lose our spirit, we lose our culture, we lose our way of life, we truly lose our being, and we leave nothing for the ones that come after us. And if we do that, you know, we lose our existence.
There's a fear of what might it look like in the future? I don't know, 50 years down the road. What might it look like? What happens today is certainly going to have an impact in what's going to happen down the road. And if we don't address that, if we don't address that, the fear for me is that it's going to be very desolate down the road. If you love the land, you're going to protect it. If you love your family, you're going to protect your family.
We pass resolution as a governing body, as a sovereign nation here within what is called Wisconsin. And we have an obligation to make sure that we protect that for the next seven generations.
The Red Cliff Band fears the precedents it could set if the company were to be allowed to bottle Lake Superior water.
I raised this lake with my grandfather years and years ago. He died when I started medical school, before I started medical school. But we raced out here. And it's, sometimes you can hear flocks of geese out here, huge flocks of red-winged blackbirds, the sounds of other people far away poling canoes. And otherwise, it's just me and Ivy gathering food the way our people have always done it. This is manumen. This is wild rice. It needs to be harvested respectfully and gently. And we're just starting. So hopefully we get a lot of rice, but we'll get what we get. We'll parch it in a kettle I got from my mother that was from her aunt and has been in the family forever. It's a treaty kettle. And this is healthy food. This is a healthy way to gather food. It's a healthy way to remember our relatives. I rice the same way my grandfather riced. If you have things that you're grandparents did, or your aunts and uncles did, or family did. Those things are important, and they're important to who you are, and they're important to share with other people. So, we'll get back to ricing. And remember to call an elder. They've been waiting for your call. I'm Dr. Arnie Vineo, and this is Health Matters.
A A growing Native business called Eighth Fire Solar near the White Earth Reservation of Minnesota is competing with industry giants to heat your home using cutting-edge solar technology. The company says they're the only business specializing in this technique currently in the U.S.
I'm Winona LaDuke, and I'm part of the management collective of Eighth Fire Solar, which emerged from Honor the Earth and Ah King. This is our production facility in Ponsford, Minnesota, which we put up about 3 years ago. We've been adding to it, and we make solar thermal panels here for houses, south-facing walls of houses, that it'll keep you warm in the wintertime. It can save up to 20% of your heating bill. That's a really significant thing in Minnesota winters.
The word is getting out that it's free heat from the sun.
The south-facing solar panel gets hot, and when the thermostat hits about 90 degrees, it turns on a blower fan that blows the hot air in your house.
My name is Ron Chilton. I am the project manager at Eighth Fire Solar. That will be the back of your solar panel when we get to the final assembly over there. And from there, it goes to this assembly table right here.
Native people know how to take care of community. That's really our responsibility. And I'm a, you know, matriarch in my community. And my job is to take care of my community's well-being. And one of the ways you take care of community well-being is ensuring that your people are warm. And so Eighth Fire Solar gives us a chance to reaffirm heat security or warmth in our community, and then to share that, you know, with other communities and build income, you know, employ local people, train more local people in both installing and manufacturing, so we kind of rebuild some economic systems in our community, and as well, you know, are able to offer a way to warm your house for our people.
We've been to different reservations, Leech Lake, Boys Fort, on solar installation trainings, and what we're doing out there is we're heating somebody's house, and we're also teaching the community, the tribal members out there, how to put these solar panels on. So whenever that tribe wants to buy some solar panels, they'll have the installers right there on their, in their community. If you're gonna put one solar panel on, you're looking at $5,000, and that's gonna pay for itself in 5-7 years. It's going to cost you for the solar panel, it's going to cost you for the fan, the controller, thermostat, and then the installation, and that's about it. You never have to pay again. You know, you'll have to buy a filter once in a while and change your filter, but there ain't really no maintenance on them. It takes about $8 a year to run that fan. And then over here we have a table saw. This table saw here is for cutting our polyiso, and that is that expensive aluminum sheets up there.
The White Earth Reservation, like many other communities in the north, suffers from a lot of cold in the wintertime, and over the past 20 years, most of the wood-fired heat has been moved to fossil fuels. There's a lot of problems associated with that, you know, as we recently saw in Texas with the grid breakdowns. You could lose power in your house if you have an electric heat, and then you're kind of in trouble. We're really interested in how you reduce stress in these times of climate change. And in that, you know, as the winters go, you know, between different heat temperatures and we don't know what's going on, we want to relocalize and build resilient housing. So the White Earth Reservation suffers from what's called fuel poverty. A lot of people suffer from that, where low-income people are spending a fifth to a quarter of their income on energy, a lot of it in the wintertime heating your homes. It's said that it's like eat or heat is what goes on in some homes. And you know, we need to really, in the times of now and the times ahead with climate chaos, we need to prepare our communities to be more resilient. And this is how we're gonna do it. In part, different kinds of you know, energy efficiency, retrofitting, and solar thermal. And the transition from fossil fuels needs to be aggressive, and it's here. And Eighth Fire Solar is part of that process because, you know, in manufacturing these, you can reduce the carbon footprint of a house significantly, and most of the products that we use are made in Minnesota or Wisconsin. The applications of solar thermal are many, and one of them is indeed in the farming community, because the fact is that we're going to need to have more local food security. We discovered that during the pandemic when we saw that food systems were collapsing because there was no local food systems, and in fact most of the food was for market and national and international movement. In the economy of the future, we want to have as much local food as we can. And in order to extend the growing seasons in northern Minnesota, particularly in some of our greenhouses, we found that solar thermal can increase the ability of a greenhouse to extend its season, perhaps into the full winter.
According to 8th Fire Solar, Anishinaabe prophecies reveal we're in the time of the seventh fire. The company says at this time, it is said we have a choice between a path that is well-worn and scorched and a path that is green and unworn. If we move toward the green path, the eighth fire will be lit and people will come together to make a better future.
There's a lot of challenges with the lure of technology, and it's really hard on the emotional system. So I'm gonna ask you all, if you can put that down, get your hands in the dirt, spend some time with Mother Earth. We are children of this earth and we're all interconnected. So it's really seductive to wanna be really involved in technology, but make sure you're in this world as well. You know, make sure you're connected with the spirits that are around you, the plants, the animals, the insects. It's healing to get your hands into the earth. It's healing to be around humans that can support you and love you. And it's a temptation to not do that because it's easy and it feeds your ego to not do that. But let's get out of that and remind ourselves who we really are.
Now to Oklahoma, the home of a native-run meat processing plant called Quapaw Cattle Company. The company honors traditional values in utilizing all parts of the animals. Their jerky, steaks, and other beef products go to the farmer's market.
The cattle company is one of Quapaw's food sovereignty efforts, which provide for the entire region, not just the tribe, and have helped combat food insecurity during the pandemic.
The Quapaw Nation has been kind of a forerunner in Indian country, starting off a lot of the ventures that we're in. I mean, this is, to me, a family ranch. I get to come here every day and do what I love to do. I wouldn't trade this for the world. I really wouldn't. I would show up here every day if I had to do it on my own. It's just something I love to do. It's in your blood. As long as you give them space, they'll move from you. They don't want to be messed with. I don't want to give them the opportunity to charge me. I'm Mitch Albright, Director of Agriculture for the Quapaw Nation. I am a tribal member. Starting back in 2012, I think, leadership at that time wanted to start a cattle company to produce proteins and meats for the tribe, not only for our elders but in our youth, but also for our agribusinesses and casinos. So we have the cow-calf operation, the bison operation, and we also have a feeding facility. It's about 400 acres. We house anywhere from 1,500 to 2,000 head of yearling cattle for yearling producers year-round. We actually built the processing facility the fall of 2017, 25,000 square foot. We opened with 7 people. It's the first USDA-inspected tribal facility that's on trust land in the United States. I think for us, it's just a point of professional pride that a tribe can take care of itself. It's that food sovereignty aspect that the tribe's pushing for, to be able to produce locally grown, hormone-free products to all of its members and its businesses. The cattle company is a lot bigger than what is just cattle. We have a mercantile farmers market group that takes care of, you know, the greenhouses, the farmers markets, tutorials, you name it.
Snap peas are starting to show up. That's good.
My name's Michelle Bowden. I'm a member of the Quapaw Nation. I also work for the tribe as the agriculture environmental specialist. When I came in, we started really doing a lot of brainstorming on some of the things that we can do outside of just our meat processing. So we decided to add on our gardens, try to teach people. I do a lot of videos, a lot of workshops that I bring people in and try to teach them either food preservation or gardening techniques, things like that.
And you know, all of that webbing right there gives its flavor.
You know, we have a sovereign right to be able to feed ourselves appropriate foods that our generations have been raised upon. The bison's always been an integral part of the Native American communities throughout the United States, not just the Quapaws. We don't ever produce more than we actually need. We don't slaughter more than we actually need. I'm so glad to see that we're trying to bring bison back to the plains.
It takes so much more to raise buffalo than it does beef cattle. Buffalo are very territorial. Don't hurt anybody while we're here and on video. Stressors are huge on buffalo. You know, buffalo by nature are migratory. They were meant to move. They were never meant to stay in captivity like we do here. So we treat them like beef, like bovine, but they don't work the same. Keeping stress down on buffalo is priority one. It doesn't matter if they're in the pasture, if they're in a handling facility. They were how our people survived years ago. I've just kind of taken it upon myself to be a part of those that take care of them from here on out. The pandemic we've been going through, I think it's opened a lot of folks' eyes on how are you going to feed your people? How are you going to feed your family?
Food sovereignty, it's our way of being able to provide for ourselves and make it sustainable for ourselves. A lot of people these days have gotten away from your traditional gardening. A lot of people don't know how to grow things from seed and be able to feed themselves. So we're always looking to showcase some of the things that we do so people can come in and learn from us.
Oh, yep, that one here, we do have one in here that's still going.
Really, in this garden, I'm producing mostly stuff to go to our farmers market. So I try to get things that are going to be marketable, whether it be cucumbers, squash, zucchini. I've started strawberries this year. We have a kids' garden located at our daycare center. They can go out in the afternoon and be able to pick what they want or go water it. We're just trying to teach them kind of at a young age how to grow their own food. I also have a seed-saving garden that we have isolated from a lot of other things. And we have a Superfund site in Pitcher, Oklahoma that has actually been remediated in a certain area. So I've used that as my garden for specifically seed-saving. So this here is one of our remediated sites, as you can see in the background. Those are our chat piles. It's basically mining waste that they have dug out of the ground while they were mining lead for bullets for the wars. I mean, it's obviously something that the United States needed at the time, but when it was left behind, this is what we were left with. The Quapaw tribe was one of the first tribes of the United States that was able to take over their own remediation projects of a Superfund site. So we definitely feel that we're the best stewards of this land, considering it is our territory. And we feel like we're gonna go above and beyond to make sure that we're putting this back into production and making it safe and healthy for everybody. We are really considered in a food desert. There's a long way you have to go, very few options for fresh foods. You can go to a convenience store and get something processed, but that doesn't necessarily translate into healthy alternatives for people. The Quapaw Farmers Market and Food Hub is an excellent place for everybody to gather, for us to all feel a sense of community. And we're really trying to incorporate this more into an actual store setting than, say, an In-N-Out. There's just not a whole lot here in Quapaw, so we really want to make it accessible for everybody to have fresh vegetables, fruits. Hi, how are y'all doing? Good, come on in. We've got all of our beef products on that left side. There's a few bratwursts that we got in that middle cooler, and then our bison is on this far right-hand side. Yes. I do believe very strongly in working for my people, so therefore when I came to the Quapaw tribe, I know that food's important and it makes me feel just incredible and definitely needed. I really don't know how else to describe it. I feel like I have a purpose.
Hopefully the story has inspired some other tribes to do what we're doing, to reach out, and even in Indian country as a whole, to establish a foothold in Indian ag and take it to the next level. That's the whole point of doing what we're doing. And then we're just putting a tribal spin on it, and it makes everybody feel good. Everybody in the community knowing that they're eating products raised here from the ground they live on, the ground that they grew up on. That's the whole point.
Quapaw food initiatives have expanded to include honey and coffee, as well as the beef and bison products. If you missed a show or want to catch up online, find us at nativereport.org and follow us on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram for behind-the-scenes updates. And drop a comment on social media if you enjoyed the show.
Thanks for spending time with your friends and neighbors across Indian Country. I'm Rita Karpinen.
And I'm Ernie Stevens. We'll see you next time on Native Report.